Hi, it's Caitlin. Children's Church is now online. Kids can check out fun Bible games, videos, and activities while you watch the Sabbath webcast. So cool. Be sure to check it out. Visit PPM Kids on this website.
Father, we have a word I read in the book, and it said, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. So today, Father, I have no needs because the Lord is my shepherd, and my needs are met. Have no need for no greater finances, no need for greater health, no need for greater well-being, because the Lord has met my needs. The word says that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Because the Lord is my shepherd, my need, my man. Father, we ask that you bless pleasant place of ministry. We ask that you bless all those that enter these doors. Continue to bless and strengthen the pastors. Nurture the word that you have placed upon them in their hearts. Bless the leadership. Bless the congregants. Bless the children. Bless all those who put their will, their shoulder to the wheel to lift up your name. Father, if there's anything that we've done that it fell short of your expectations, we ask that you bless us and give us the strength, Father, to shoulder the burden, to help those that are in need, to do your will, Father. As we go forth on our daily journey, we ask for continued mercies, continued guidance, and continue to direct our path, Father. Remove anything that is hurtful, harmful, or dangerous, may be seen or unseen. Remove it from us, Father. Continue to bless us with the needs that we have. Father, that we have many wants, many needs. Place them all upon the throne of grace today, Father, for your blessings. Father, is anyone under the sound of my voice that is not right in their body, in their mind, in their daily walk, Father, we ask that you reach out and touch them. Grant them the mercies that they need to move forward, Father. To God be the glory. May God get the glory out of this.
September, because the season ain't gonna last no more.
Hello, and welcome to Pleasant Place Ministries webcast. So glad that you would tune in to us today, that you would be here to join with us. I thank God for you, and I thank God for this season. We're in the harvest season. This is a season in which God pours out his most bountiful blessing. And I'm going to tell you something, it has already started. I got a phone call earlier this evening, and I got some wonderful news for our brother Vernon Scott. Amen. It seems today about 4 o'clock this morning, as I hear, he got a phone call from Piedmont Hospital, and he told him to come on down. You see, Mr. Vernon, Mr. Scott, it's been several years ago now. His blood pressure spiked. I believe he was at work and he was rushed to the hospital. And in doing so, it destroyed his kidneys. Since that time, he has been on dialysis, and it changed his life drastically. But because he was such a young man and in reasonable amount of health, that he was a candidate for a kidney transplant. Now, years had gone by, season had gone by, and nothing was available up until a few months ago, in which he was called in again. But at that time when he went in, his vitals was a little off balance, a little abnormal, off track, and they weren't able to do it. So he had to go home again, disappointed. But this morning, yes, this morning, and in this season, he has undergone a successful kidney transplant, and we're speaking this in Jesus' name. He should be in recovery right now. We and his father and other family members and friends and relatives, we're just rejoicing at what God is doing, has done for him. He has gotten a miracle in this season. A miracle. He got his miracle in this season. And I just thank God for it. I'm excited about it because I see other things that are taking place in this season. Now, let me tell you, man and woman of God, I've seen some of you in the future. Yes, I've heard your future testimony years from now. I heard it. And listen, you didn't mention anything about a pandemic. You didn't mention anything about a virus. Your testimony in this season was about how God blessed you, how you received a miracle in this season. God, listen to me. God has a miracle for you. God has a bountiful blessing for you in this season. Those of us who are in Christ Jesus, did you know that makes us a candidate for a miracle? Just like Brother Vernon. And I'm praying to God right now for you that you don't miss him in this season. You know God works in season. He does. God often works in season. That's how God's economy is set up. He says, sow and you'll reap. You sow in season and you reap in season. Still don't believe me. Ecclesiastes 3:1 says, to everything there's a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. Hello, somebody. Look at your neighbor right now and say, this is my season. Hallelujah for me to receive my miracle. We are in harvest season. In just a few days, we're going to enter right into the Feast of Tabernacles. This is the harvest season. You can go back over Leviticus 23 and read upon that. I might talk a little bit about that more probably next week. But today I want to emphasize to you, don't miss God. Don't miss God's blessing on your life in this season. In Genesis, the 8th chapter, in the 22nd verse, he says, this is after Noah had, the ark had landed. Noah had given an offering up to God. It pleased him. He says, while the earth remains, seed time and harvest. That's a season. You plant, you reap. That's a season. He says cold and heat, summer and winter. Those are seasons. Seasons. Day and night will not cease. Amen. Amen. We are in that season. And I'm telling you, I've been talking to some of the saints. I've been speaking to some of God's people. And God is moving right now in this season. God's people are being blessed. And I don't want you to miss. I don't want you to miss, hallelujah, seeing God move in this season. That's why I'm praying for you. I'm pouring my heart out for you that you see God in this season. And it's faith, listen, that calls us to reap in this season. I want to share a little something with you that even in this season, listen, even if you hadn't even planted in this season, you can still reap. How are you going to do that? How are you going to do that? Listen, all you have to do is join forces with the reapers. If you help the reapers out in this season. Did you know God made provision? He called it for gleaners. For those that would glean. Hallelujah. Those that did not have it to plant. God has so richly blessed. And God is so richly blessing in this season. If you would just help a reaper out. God would cause them to allow some things to just fall your way. Oh, in this season, you call it gleaning. Hallelujah. But it takes faith to see God's hand. It takes faith in this season. You remember the Syrophoenician woman that had a child that was, I believe she was perplexed. I believe she was vexed with a devil. I believe that's what it was, if my memory serves me correctly. And Jesus, hallelujah, came away and she began to cry out to him, Lord, Lord, save my child, deliver my child. Lord, Lord, save, deliver my child. And Jesus turns to her because she wasn't even a member of the household of faith. In other words, she wasn't a Jew. Save my child. Hallelujah. He says, you know, the children bread is not meat or it's not given to the unbeliever. He actually said to dogs. And she said, yes, Lord, but even the bread that fall from the master tables, the crumbs, the dog eat. Faith. He says, go your way. Child, heal your faith in this season. Come on, somebody. If you didn't even sow in this season, if you got faith enough, hallelujah, to recognize God's presence in your life, God's hand, hallelujah, and handiwork, watch this, right here in your life, God's bountiful protection right here. If you have enough faith to see it, listen, you can receive it. We sing a little song at church during the offering time. It says, I'm going to get my blessing. I'm going to get my blessing. If I believe it, then I'll receive it. Come on, somebody. I'm going to get my blessing. I see God's hand and handiwork everywhere right now. Got a phone call. It was last week. One young lady, she was homeless, really, and she was in a shelter. And through one of the city programs, they provided her with a home. And I spoke with her father, and her father says that, listen, I took her over to the house, and the house is completely empty. There is nothing in it. I'm telling you, within 7 days, I spoke with him tonight. He said that house now is full of furniture. It's full of furniture because when the word went out, amen, God's people, you hear me? God's people, hallelujah, began to release things from their own home, amen, to fill that house. I'm telling you, This is how it works. God is blessing in this season. Watch this. It is not just to those, listen, that are in need, those that have their houses full. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm challenging you today to look around. Hallelujah. Because God is getting ready to want to replace some stuff in your house. Amen. It happened to me. I was upstairs. I wanted to create me a new office in one of the bedrooms upstairs. And I told my wife, everything. I want everything to go. Everything. She said, yeah, but that was new. And that, everything. I heard the Spirit of the Lord said new. I'm replacing with new. Hallelujah. The same God that said it is the same God that will provide it. And I'm just believing God for it right now. Hallelujah. And I'm praying, listen, that your faith fail not. That you will see what God is doing right now. Many men and women of God cannot see God's hand and handiwork in their lives. Even now, many of us allow our hearts to get so weighed down, amen, by the things that are going on, hallelujah, that we cannot see God. We can't see Him move. You know, over in Matthew 5 and 8, it says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. We can't see because we're so our hearts are so blinded, hallelujah, because we are focused, amen, on our situation. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians 4:4, it says, for the God of this age has blinded the minds, but he's talking about of the unbeliever. Now, Satan cannot blind your mind because you are a believer towards God, but what he can do, and what he does a wonderful job of doing, is troubling your heart so much that you stay focused so much on your problems, focus so much on your present situations, focus so much on the storms that you fail to see the rescue, that you fail to see the deliverance right before your eyes. Hallelujah. Many of God's people miss their miracle focusing on their challenges. Don't miss your miracle. I'm here today, listen, to tell you, do not miss your miracle. Hallelujah. Listen, you're only in this challenge, amen, so you can receive a miracle. And my prayer for you today is, God, open the eyes of our heart that we might clearly see you. Open the eyes of our hearts that we might clearly see you. You see, you don't need to be able to see with your natural eye to have faith. The Bible says we walk by faith and not by sight. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing from the word of God. I want to take you to the text today in 2 Kings, the 6th chapter, where the king of Syria was at war with Israel. And Elisha, the prophet, amen, kept thwarting his plans. Every time the king of Syria thought that they had Israel trapped or they had gotten them to come into an ambush, somebody would always tell what the king of Syria was up to, so much so that he thought that he had a spy among his own ranks. And one day his servant came to him and told him, said, nah, we don't have a spy in the ranks, but there is a man, there is a prophet down over in Israel that's telling the Israel king everything you whisper in your bedroom. And so the king of Syria said, we got to get this dude. Well, no, we got to trap him. So somebody go down, find out where he is, and we're going to set up a trap to capture him. Because if we can get the man of God, hallelujah, if we can get the one that's warning him, then we can get to Israel. I like to play role play when I look into the scripture and I began to read, and I like to play some names and people. We're going to call Syria the adversary, and we're going to be Israel ourselves. Hallelujah. Syria the adversary, and Israel ourselves. The king of Syria was at war with Israel. You got an adversary that's at war with you. Hallelujah. But I want you to know today that God has a prophet, amen, that's looking out for your behalf. God has a prophet, amen, that's keeping the devil, listen, under his feet. The reason you hadn't gone under now is because God has somebody, listen, standing in the gap on your behalf, praying on your behalf. And if you've been assigned to me, amen, I'm the one. Those of you, you may have pastors. Listen, it may be your grandma still praying for you. Hallelujah. Be it as it may, whoever it may be, God has somebody assigned to your life. Why? Because you're his. And you are a candidate for a miracle. Oh, my goodness, you ought to be happy about now. You are a candidate for a miracle. Let's go. 2 Kings 6, verse, we're going to start at 11, 6 chapter, starting 11 verse. Therefore, the heart of the king of Syria was so troubled for this thing, and he called his servants, and he said unto them, will ye not show me which one is for the king of Israel? And one of his servants said, none, my lord, O king, but Elisha the prophet that is in Israel telleth the king of Israel the words that thou speaketh in the bedchamber. And he said, go spy where he is, and I may send and fetch him. And it was told him, saying, behold, he is in Dothan. Therefore sent he thither horses and chariots and a great host, and they came by night, and they compassed the city about. In other words, he says, when they got to Dothan, listen, they surrounded the city. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early, listen, that's Isaiah's servant. When he got up early that morning, he came out, and a host, hallelujah, hallelujah, passed the city, both with horses and chariots. And the servant said unto his master, he said, alas. He didn't say, what shall we do? He said, how shall we do? And he answered, this is Elijah. He says, fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them. Listen to what Elijah answered to his servant. Elijah, the man of God, came out. He looked around and listened. They were surrounded. Let's say they had 3,000 men. Let's say they had 30,000 men. It didn't matter. Amen. Elisha's servant looking at Elisha, and he said, boss, we done for. They finally found us. They got us. 30,000 to 2. And he looks at Elisha, and Elisha clap his hands and say, oh boy, we got them just where we want them. Look at God, look at God, look at God. God has now delivered them into our hands. We got them just where we want them. And I know his servant probably saying, my boss has lost his mind. And Elijah says, no. Hallelujah. Because all he had to do was lift his eyes just a little bit, hallelujah, to the surrounding hills. And he said, but it's more with us than it is with them. And you know that's how it is when we are men and women of God. Hallelujah. He says, he that is within us is greater than he that is within the world. And Elijah in verse 18, and when they came down to him, Elijah prayed and asked the Lord that he might smite them. And he smitten them with blindness, and all of them was blind. But just prior to that, the Lord, Elijah prayed unto God for his servant. And he says, Lord, open his eyes. Hallelujah. That he may see. Oh, my goodness, what I see. And that day, Elijah's servant saw God's presence. He saw God's protection. And he saw God's provision. My goodness, and that's my prayer for you. That even in your circumstances, even in your situation, your heart is not so troubled that you cannot see God's presence. That you cannot see God's protection. And that you cannot see God's provision. God, open our eyes that we might see you. Hallelujah. When things look like they're going bad. Hallelujah. In some of the roughest situations, amen, create some of the best opportunities. Things are opening up all around us, even while we're social distancing. Hallelujah. Even while in many places we are commanded to stay at home, opportunities are opening up all around us. Some things are totally shutting down, listen, but other things are opening wide open. My goodness, my God. Hallelujah. Listen. I am praying that God, that you don't miss this miracle. Hallelujah. He's moving right now. And he's moving on your behalf. Things are happening even as I speak. Right now, we're right in the midst of it. If we just see God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But you know, one thing that kind of shake me is that even when some of us get a glimpse of what God is doing in our lives, we still tend to shy away. Hallelujah. We still tend to exercise a lack of faith. You remember over in the book of Mark, 10th chapter, where Jesus was walking along the road and there was a man seated over to the side of the road, a blind man, physically blind. Amen. But not in his heart, because he heard that Jesus was passing by and he knew that he was able, amen, to heal him of his physical blindness. He could see, amen, the healer coming when those that was right next to him couldn't even see it. And he cried out unto God, hallelujah. Savior, Lord, hallelujah, have mercy on me. And even when those that would try and make him quiet, but keep him quiet, he cried out all the more. Listen, when you have that kind of faith, your circumstances, hallelujah, the things that try to shut you up, amen, can't shut you up because of that faith that God has placed down in you. And he cried out in faith. And you know what Jesus did? He stopped and he says, tell him to come over here. And he got up and he went to him. But you know, this is what got me. Jesus asked him, what is it that you would have me do for you? Of course you would think, hey, he's blind. He wants to see it, have his sight. But do you know many of us, we would have settled for a seeing our dog. Some of us, that's where we live right now. We got dog faith. We got dog faith. If I can just get a seeing our dog, that's all I need. I come that you might have life and that you might have it abundantly. I want to receive my sight. He jumped to his, I want to receive my sight. And the Lord healed him. But he asked him, what is it that you would have me do for you? He saw him for who he was, the Christ. He saw him, listen, with blinded eyes, he could see better than many. You remember over in the Gospel of John, 5th chapter, at the pool of Bethesda, when Jesus walked about almost like an infirmary, people lame and halt everywhere, and he found this young one man that had been paralyzed for years. And I want to show you a little something about seasons. And the Bible says, and in a certain season, I want to tell you, God works in season. God works in seasons. And in a certain season, an angel was assigned, listen, to come down and trouble the waters. Come on, somebody. You ought to see where I'm going now. Hadn't your waters been troubled in this season? Hasn't your waters been troubled in this season? I'm telling you, God has given the angel an assignment, hallelujah, to trouble your waters that you might receive your miracle in this season. But you know what Jesus asked him? Will thou be made whole? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know what you need. Don't allow the adversary to attack your faith to the point in which you ask for something less than what you need. He said, I come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. You worried about how you're going to get it, how you're going to do it. Hallelujah. He just asked you, what is it that you want? Some of you need an automobile. You need transportation. And you'll settle for a motor car. Hello. Why sell yourself short? You settle for public transportation. God says, do you want to be made whole? You have a great need. Hallelujah. The supplier of all our needs is right here before you. The angel has come. He's troubled your waters. Can't you see God's hand at work in it? Can't you see him moving in your life? Hallelujah. God is offering you a precious gift. Brother Vernon was offered a kidney. He's taking it. He's coming off of dialysis. Hallelujah. And as soon as he recovers, I pray that he go out and live life to the fullest. Amen. Do you know, amen, for him to walk around whole, for him to walk around healthy, hallelujah, is a testimony in and of itself. When people see him, they see the handiwork of God in his life. Hallelujah. Don't you know when he go back down to the dialysis clinic, that those that are sitting around in the chairs and hooked up to the machines, listen, how much faith did it just give them? If he'll do it for him, oh my goodness, oh my God, that might be a chance for me. Hallelujah. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. He's a walking hope. He's a walking testimony. Amen. The Bible is full of these examples where men and women have seen God in their lives, and it caused the ordinary man to do extraordinary things. You have an angel assigned to you in this season. Hallelujah. He's here to bless you. Listen, seeing God also gives us a boldness to move forward into God's will and into God's plan. Seeing God. I'm not talking about no outward appearance. I mean, seeing God's hand and God's handiwork in your life, how he's blessing you, how he's blessing his people. Hallelujah. Those are those that have faith enough to receive it. Amen. Amen. We see examples throughout the Bible. You remember Moses, who had the stammering tongue? He was terrified to go and speak before Pharaoh, but he moved on ahead to lead Israel, amen, into freedom because he saw God in the burning bush. That's a sight he would never forget. God's presence in that burning bush. And then to see God, listen, and a pillar of fire, hallelujah, by night, and a great cloud by day. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He wasn't afraid no more. You know why? Because he could see God, hallelujah, with him. God's presence, God's protection, and God's provision, hallelujah, throughout all of those years that they walked throughout the desert. And then, why you think that Samuel grew into such a great leader, a man of God? Because God appeared to Samuel, calling him out in the temple in the middle of the night. He continually stayed before God. He could see God, and it gave him the courage, and it gave him the faith to be the man of God that he was. And why didn't David fear Goliath? When everybody else was trembling in their boots, it was because he had seen, listen, the true and the living God. And he wasn't worried about a man. Yeah, they say he was a giant, but to David, he was just a man. Because God had given him, amen, a bear and a lion, hallelujah, as he would deliver the lambs that he was to oversee. He knew that God was with him. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And why did Isaiah say, Lord, here I am, send me? He said, because I saw him in the temple and he was high and lifted up. Hallelujah. And it gave him the boldness to go out and preach his word to a people that didn't even want to hear him. Don't miss your miracle. Don't miss your miracle. God is moving in this season, and all you have to do is see him. See him. Open your eyes. Open the eyes of your heart. I started off talking about Brother Vernon. Thank God for his miracle. I thank God for his life. I thank God for his children. Hallelujah. I thank God for using him to be an example, even now in this time. But Jesus has given us something very valuable. Just as Brother Vernon was given, gifted even, a kidney, Christ gave his blood for us. Just as I pray for Brother Vernon for his kidney transplant, that his body will not reject the kidney, I pray even more so for us that we won't reject that which God has given us, eternal life, through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Don't reject the gift of God. Lord, I pray, open our eyes. Open the eyes of our heart that we might see you, receive you, and receive that which you have for us. Don't let us miss our miracle, especially in this harvest miracle season. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. God bless you, and may he continually bless you and keep you. Amen.
An altar built, a table spread, a tree that grew, a life was spared. Between two thorns, justice was placed, blood for the world, amazing grace. Oh, how I'm drawn to the cross alone, the place where mercy and sin atone, the place where